Hello, and we are live on YouTube. Just going to introduce myself. I'm Lance Steen Anthony Nielsen, the writer and director of Kent State. And on with me is Suzette Pluck, one of the producers of the show. And shortly we'll be introducing you to some of our cast. A small number of our cast are joining us today, but we'll introduce you to them in a moment. What we're going to do first is we're actually going to show you a clip from episode one. I'm also going to explain just why my backdrop is different today. Behind me is the poster for the Hillsborough Justice Campaign. I was an active member of the Justice Campaign for a few years. And I had the honor and the privilege of writing and directing a play about the events of the Hillsborough football disaster called Waiting for Hillsborough, which was on in London in 1997 and on in Liverpool in 1998. And it is the anniversary of the Hillsborough football disaster today. So I've had this as my backdrop today. I'll be changing it in a little bit, but I thought I'd just let people watching know why I've got a different background today. Suzette, anything you want to say before we do a clip of episode one?
If you haven't watched it, you can go onto the Outcast Creative YouTube page and watch it there, so you'll be in time to watch episode two on Sunday, so you can catch up.
Yeah, and presumably people know where that is, because if you're watching this now, you will have found your way to the Outcast Creative page on YouTube.
Oh, yeah.
So I had some issues with sound earlier, despite doing tests and various other things. The technical mechanisations of the fun that is Zoom still occasionally eludes me. But I'm hoping that you guys will be able to hear the sound on this. Now, for the benefit of YouTube, I just want to say that we completely own all the rights to the work I'm about to put up. So there should be no issues there. We're simply showing a clip of our own work. So we're going to show that now. And Suzette, if there's any issues with the sound, you will frantically text me.
I will.
And I'll pause it and try and fix it.
Yeah.
But let's see if we can resolve this without any issues. And hopefully we can show you a clip of what was episode one, this broadcast last Sunday. It's already at 1,150 views. So it's nice that people are supporting it and coming to watch it. We've had tremendous feedback. We'll talk about that more later. Without further ado, here's about a four or five minute clip from episode one, which is going to feature some of our actors who are on tonight. Others you're going to get to meet in episode two. Right, so give me a second, and hopefully with the wonders of modern technology, we can show you this clip.
Now, be it by design or pure chance, a destiny has been placed in our hands. And that destiny is to uphold the vital freedoms of speech and assembly. And all of you here will need to play your part. How you all present yourselves to the jury in that courtroom will be just as important as how I present the evidence.
So your appearance, your demeanor, even the way you wear your hair, it's all going to come under the most intense kind of scrutiny. Now, once that trial starts, everything you do and everything you say, what you wear and how you look, is going to weigh heavily on every single member of that jury. Now, those of you who have long hair, you're going to have to get it cut.
Oh, come on.
Surely it's important for us to be able to express ourselves freely. I mean, isn't that what this trial is all about?
Well, exactly. I am not cutting mine. It's that simple.
You don't have a choice, Alan.
I'm with
come
Alan.
On. Come on.
Guys,
hey.
Really?
understand where you're coming from. I do. But the jury won't. Okay, the defense are going to try and paint you all as an unruly mob that made their clients fear for their lives.
Exactly. We're also going to need you all to attend court as much as possible. The jurors are going to have to sit through some long and difficult days, and you have to show that you're prepared to share that burden right there with them. Otherwise, how can you expect them to sympathize with you?
Yeah, I have to agree. So, gentlemen, that short haircuts, suits, and neckties whenever you're in that courtroom.
Well, fine, I'm buying a wig then. I'm not letting those bastards dictate how I look. Jesus.
How's a wig gonna make your hair shorter?
All right, fine, you know what? I'll put it in a ponytail, hide it under a beret. How about that?
That's ridiculous. You don't want people to think you're Che Guevara.
Mr. Kellner, I don't want to be the pessimist in the room, but not one person in authority, police, guardsmen, or any other branch with men wearing a uniform, to my knowledge, has ever been convicted of an unjustified killing.
Unjustified murder? Sorry, but our Sandra was murdered. There's no two ways about it. And I want the people that shot and killed my daughter, who was going, doing nothing more than walking to her class, to pay for what they did.
That's like our bill.
Yeah. Right, Mrs. Sawyer. So I wondered, realistically, what you think our chances are, Mr. Kellner, before we all start believing in false hope here.
I can't make any promises.
But being from New York, you really don't know the people around here, Mr. Kellner. They hate us. They wanted us shot. They think we deserved it.
Yeah, just read the local papers, man. When my friend came home from Kent after the shootings, you want to know what her father said when she told him she'd seen one of her friends shot?
What'd he say?
That he wishes they'd shot more of us. You have to understand, Mr. Kellner, the moment we get in that courtroom, that
it's going to be all of us against them. It'll be all of us in here who are going to be on trial, not the guardsmen, and they were the ones who shot us.
Oh, this isn't a simple road accident case where someone has been run over by a car.
Okay, I think we're all aware of that.
It's worse than a car. We've been run over by the governor and the whole state of Ohio. And any jury we get is going to see this case as them versus the entire anti-war movement, which they all see as nothing more than a bunch of hippies and communists.
Yeah, well, this was the first time my son Jeff had even been to a rally for anything. Yeah, and even if he was against the war, he had every right to be there.
There's a difference between being anti-war and part of the anti-war movement. Need to get that across to the jury, Mr. Kellner.
And our William was just going to class. He wasn't even part of the demonstration. My son certainly isn't no hippie communist.
Hey, what are you saying, Louis? That my Allison was a damn commie?
No, but this is America, not the Soviet Union. And we better remember that when we get in that there courtroom.
Well, look, we might as well be living in Russia for all the freedom that we have in this country. The rights to freedom.
I honestly don't think being hippie communist is the worst.
Okay. And let me pause it. Let me pause it there. Okay. And that's the first time all the plaintiffs and the families get together. That scene did happen. That argument, by the way, did happen. That really happened. I had quite a lot of detail and input on that scene from the Kellners, who of course witnessed the whole thing. There's also extensive description about it in this book. I don't know if you can see that because it's going to bleach out with my background. The Kent State cover-up, which was actually published a few years after Kent State. So, Suzette, would you like to introduce our four cast members now?
Right. First off, we have Nadia Lamin, who is playing Allison Krause on episode 2 on Sunday, who is one of the four students that sadly lost her life on that day. And she's doing a stellar job in rehearsals.
Nadia Lamin, please come on down.
Show your face.
Hi.
Hiya.
Thank you, Nadia, for joining us today. And if anybody watching has any questions for any of our cast members at any time, just let us know. Someone called Amy Harvey has posted a flaming picture of fire. I don't know if that means that they think Nadia's hot or if they think the show's hot or if the show is tempestuous.
The show's hot. The show is hot.
Maybe she'll ask a question. Who's our next guest?
And we also have Debra Leigh-Taylor, who's playing, she looks far too young for this, but she's going to be playing Nadia's mother on the episode.
Oh, Suzette, thank you.
Doris Krause, welcome.
Good evening. Lovely to be here.
I think playing Doris Krause would be the full... is what Suzette meant to say.
And we also have Stephen Riddle, who will be playing Arthur Krause, the father and father of Allison and husband of Doris.
Fresh off the set from The Crown, and we'll be talking to Stephen about his many varied and excited career achievements later.
I did notice that Suzette didn't mention that I was too young to be Allison's father.
And moving on.
Yeah. And we weren't sure we were going to have him tonight, but last but by no means least, Suzette, bit of a surprise guest.
Our surprise guest is David Whalen, who will be playing Howard. No.
Hey, everyone.
A little bit more about that character.
Yeah, and Howard Ruffner was kind enough to send us some feedback on episode one, sent us congratulations, and said he's looking forward to seeing the next one, which of course he's in, with David playing him, no less. We'll talk about Howard and the amazing photographs that he took later on. So again, we're live. So if anybody watching, we've got 13 people watching at the moment, feel free to grab the link and share it anywhere you want. David, if you want the link for this live, I'll just re-drop it in the chat again for you. Sure. There you go. So if you'd like to post it anywhere while we're rabbiting on, feel free. See if you can encourage your huge female fan base out there to come and join us. That'll give us another 27 views. So our first question, Suzette, that we normally ask, I've got the list of them here. We've all been working and rehearsing very hard pretty much every day since we started this thing. I'm either working with one of the cast or five of the cast or all of the cast, depending on the day of the week. And Nadia and I were rehearsing this afternoon.
Yep.
And going over a few things. So Suzette, what's our first question for our troupe of actors today?
First question is, what character do you play? And if you could give us a little bit of background.
Perhaps expanding on that a bit, what research you did for the role in order to find the truth of that character. So while we give David a chance to do some posts and things, we'll throw that out to Nadia, first of all, who of course is playing Allison Krause.
Yeah, so, well, Lance has said it for me right there. I'm playing Allison Krause. Beth Krause, and she was an honor student at Kent State University. She was sadly killed in 1970, May 4th, on campus at Kent State by the Ohio National Guard for protesting peacefully on their own campus about the American invasion in Cambodia and Vietnam. She calls herself first and foremost a peacemaker. She was 19 years old. So it's quite tragic, really. There's so many relatable tones to her character and how she was just young, ambitious, kind, cared about people, wanted to have a good and healthy, fulfilling life, and unfortunately didn't get that chance to have it. The research, well, to be honest, the script, as I hope you all see, because I hope you do watch every episode, is so filled with it, like such amazing facts. And sometimes you can't believe that that's real or that was said. And so the script gave a lot to me. as well as, of course, the internet. When you research Allison Krause, Kent State, there's so much that pops up about her. So I was very lucky to have that information to try and do my utmost best to kind of capture her the way that I hope Lance is happy with as a director and writer, but also for people who maybe knew her and obviously, or knew of her.
Thank you.
Thanks, Nadia. And I will say that when we knew we were going to do this as a production, obviously there's a core of regulars of the Outcasts who come and do table reads with us, usually once a week. And then we have another core of actors that come to our classes. But we didn't really have anybody in our regular bunch that was right for Allison Krause. And we were talking about it prior to the casting. And I said, I know someone who I really want to work with. We've talked about working together. I don't know whether she'll be up for it, but she's bang on right, 100% for Allison Krause. And that person was you. So I consider ourselves quite lucky that we got you, because I couldn't, of the immediate people that I knew, when you're asking people to do something gratis in this industry, you really have to, we all do favors for each other when we know each other. And it's easy to ask people who know that you're prepared to do favors. So, you know, I would read a script for you if you had written a script and you wanted me to look it over or whatever. It's very hard to ask those favors of people that you don't know. And it doesn't sit right with me either. So it was great that you said yes, and then also came and did a storming audition as well. So not taking anything for granted, and you totally earned the part. And I love what you've done with it. I can't wait for people to see it.
Thank you so much. I couldn't say no. That's for sure. So.
So moving downwards on our Brady Bunch screen, Debra Leigh-Taylor, who is playing?
Doris Krause, yes.
Same question to you, Debra, and thank you for coming on as well. One of our Outcast regulars.
Yes. Doris Krause. There wasn't an awful lot of information to find about her, but I did obviously look in all the right places. I, as far as I can gather, she was born on the 3rd of November 1925, because she actually died in 2016 when she was 90.
Four or 5 years ago, so it's not.
Yeah, wasn't that long ago?
Yeah.
Which is even more sad that she lived to that age in so much pain. But she married Arthur in, I think it was, must have been 1945, I think when she was 20, because he'd just come back from World War II. And I also found out that her maiden name was Levine, which I thought, well, that's quite a coincidence, because I wasn't that a boyfriend of
Barry Levine was. I never knew that.
Well, I'm sure. Well, that's what I read anyway.
That's quite interesting, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, I'm presuming I got it right, but that's what I found. And obviously the poor woman was in terrible pain and sadness when this happened. And I think on the 30th anniversary of the Kent State, she didn't want to get involved in the memorial service, but she felt she had to go. Yeah, she felt she had to go, and this reporter apparently befriended her because she didn't want to talk about it, but he befriended her, and he said that her memory of the events was like encyclopedic. I'll quote him. He said she knew every detail of what had happened, and I think I can quote what she said about the facts about the shootings were being displaced by character assassinations. And I think that is a very polite way and controlled way to say, you know, what these people did to her. So, obviously being a mother myself, of two girls, it's for me very emotional to play this woman. As I said, she died when she was 90, so she had to live with that pain all that time.
I'm just going to let you guys know that Joe Lewis, who is one of the people portrayed in our show, played by the fantastic Paul Brennan, who's one of the American actors in our production, is watching right now. He said, Alison was attractive in every way. I saw her often as I shared a mailbox with her boyfriend, Barry Levine. And in fact, also John Allen, who got in touch with us, was Barry Levine's roommate at one point as well. This is a picture of Alison and Barry. I believe that's taken on the grounds of Kent State University from the buildings, I believe so. And Barry has spoken at several event commemorations at different times. And we do talk about him. I think in the original script, he was a character and he had dialogue and in the flashbacks and stuff. I think a lot of that got cut from this version. Although we will, I believe we do reference him at different times. And then we've had another lady come on called Rania Kurdi. I don't know if you know her, Nadia, but she's just said, Nadia is an amazing actress. So,
I know her very well. She's a wonderful actress herself. You guys should check
her out. I thought the name sounded familiar. so all of Stephen's fan base will be coming on and cramming on the chat shortly. Talk of the devil, Mr. Riddle. Would you like to introduce yourself and say who you're playing?
Hi, I'm Stephen Riddle.
You did for the role.
What? Research, yeah. Stephen Riddle, I'm playing Arthur Krause, who is the father of Alison and the husband of Doris. And I'm delighted that these two young ladies are my family in this production. They're both doing a great job. My research on Arthur... Well, he was of German Jewish descent, but he was very much American. I think it was his grandfather that first settled in America. So it goes back a little bit. But he was a very proud Republican who had his faith in his government and his country's way of doing things shaken completely by this awful event. And it's quite distressing to talk about it even. He clearly loved his daughter enormously. And he wanted justice for her. And he was very high profile after she died. And I've seen a lot of footage of him and I've read a lot about him. And every time I find a new thing about him, I find lines of dialogue that Lance has been clever enough to weave into the script. So apart from two scenes, which I imagine that most of that is words that have come from Lance with ideas that may have come from elsewhere, almost everything else he says in this whole series, he is actually reported as saying somewhere, or as there's footage of him saying somewhere. He was very, very strong-willed. And the case indeed is Krause, it's called Krause versus Rhodes, although
all the people participating in the prosecution were the parents and the wounded students, it took his name. And I think that's significant as well. He couldn't let go. And he died young, certainly young these days, at 64 with liver disease. And it's a thing one can't imagine, especially if one has children. And he had two children. He had a younger daughter as well, and it must have been very tough for all of them.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, I mean, I mentioned earlier it was the anniversary of the Hillsborough football disaster today, which I also wrote a play about. That was my first play in 97, and I got very involved with the justice campaign, and I had the most highest admiration for these families, a very eclectic, different bunch of people from different classes, working class, upper class, middle class, because there were all sorts at that football game that day. And this one flashpoint in history had taken over their whole lives, and their whole life became about getting justice for their children or their father or their brother or their sister. Or their daughter, and or daughters in the case of one family. And I just was in awe of these people and how resilient that they became. But at the same time, I saw the damage it did. And there were many of them that died young. There was a couple that died of heart attacks and things like that. And it's the thing that always kind of really annoys me is that, you know, we're as an institution, we're not, as a society, we're not built to kind of apologise, unfortunately, because of all the litigation and suing and all the rest of it. But if people just would, and they would all just hang their heads and say, we fucked up, I'm really sorry. The whole grieving process, I think, for everybody would just be that bit. It's never going to be easy, but it would be that bit easier, maybe. And I think the healing process would just be, they'd be able to facilitate it a little bit more peacefully, perhaps. It's a shame that we're not, as a society, we're not able to do those kinds. Look at what's going on with George Floyd now. I'm watching bits of that in the courtroom, and the guy he's refused to testify, which is his right. And as a serving police officer, I find that quite disgusting. That he hasn't got the cojones to get up there and actually try and justify. Well, he can't, can he? So that's why he's not. But as a serving police officer, he's a servant of the people. Anyway, get off my soapbox now, and we'll thank you for that very moving.
I've got a close friend, Lance, who was at Hillsborough, and I was hoping he was going to be watching tonight. I don't think he is. I sent him a message, and I have had a couple of messages back, but I think he'll probably watch on catch-up. So he'll be glad to hear you say that. I'd like to say as well about Arthur Krause that just as I, not intentionally, was taken quite emotionally just then, he often couldn't help himself in interviews.
And
became enormously emotional to such an extent that I saw these and I thought that's not going to work with Lance's script. It's not going to read. People will think it's an actor overdoing it. And I got a couple of friendly e-nudges by email from Nadia. And I thought I'd try it out yesterday and it worked. And I've got Nadia to thank, and actually Debra sent me a message about the same link today.
I think it's all about choosing moments, and one of the things that people said about Arthur was that he was for a long time he was seen as the leader of the group of the families, and Elaine Holstein in an interview said several times she couldn't have got through it without the moments of levity that he brought. And actually, when I heard that wasn't in the original script, because I only heard that interview. That was a later interview. The script was written in 2003. And that was an interview she gave much, much later.
Yeah.
And I thought, I don't think I've got any moments of levity with Arthur Krause. I need to get that in. So I was reading quotes from him, and that 10 cents for a cup of coffee was a thing that he said quite a lot.
Yeah. So
we got that in there and gradually sort of rebuilt the script. We've got a few comments coming in. Yeah, John Allen, again, pointing out he was Barry Levine's roommate. I had a conversation with John Allen about that. I'll share some of the other comments in a minute. I want to delay no further in introducing our fourth guest of the day, who, like myself, has recently had a haircut. The first thing we've all done since we got out of lockdown, I had mine done yesterday. David Wayman, who's a fantastic actor and a friend of mine for many years. And who are you playing, David?
So I'm playing Howard Ruffner, who was a broadcast journalism major at Kent State. Was present at the time of the shootings, took a lot of very iconic photographs.
He did indeed. And I'm not sure if everybody knows this, and I'll share it now before I hand back to David. But he took this photo, which I believe is the last photograph of Allison Krause taken alive. And that's her on the right under the pagoda. And Howard was kind enough to send me this original digital yesterday. And we have others as well. And, it's hard to kind of look at that and think that beautiful, amazing human being who probably would have made, I think, a significant contribution in her own way, as we all hope to the world. She would have done something good, I think. Was dead less than 20 minutes later, something like that. It's crazy to think that. So, David, what I mean, you had perhaps a unique set of resources that you could look at that gave you some insight into Ruffner as a young man. What research did you do for your portrayal of the character?
Yeah, so there's a lot about Howard on the internet. He's still, sorry, my phone's buzzing away there. But he's got a book available on Amazon at the moment, which has got the iconic photos in it, and there's there you have it, Moments of Truth. So there's huge amounts of stuff you can see. I mean, I think perhaps the really key bit of research for me was looking at the photographs, because that's, that really is as close as you can get to what he would have seen and experienced on the day. Some incredible work, some very harrowing photos as well.
He's our first witness on the stand. Have you, I know you've had quite an interesting and varied career in your young years of age. You're playing age of 14 to 29 with your baby face. Have you ever done anything, any characters kind of similar to this, or done anything maybe set in a legal context, or did you do any research? Because obviously how we meet you is you're the first witness in the trial.
Yeah, I mean, I've luckily never had to take a witness stand. Hope to keep it that way. It was my career as an actor has always been a bit sporadic. I've done a lot of role play work for lawyers and law firms, and it's nerve wracking even when it's not real. So, having the guts to get up there on the day and say it how it was it's no mean feat.
He's a strong character, isn't he?
And actually, when the second trial came around, just before they reached an agreement, and this was, I'm kind of spoiling things here, so perhaps I shouldn't say too much, but Howard Ruffner was the only person to take the stand twice, interestingly. And for those people watching in chat, Howard Ruffner's book is an amazing book. A chronology of his sort of photographs of that period. And I'm going to drop the link in for that now. I look forward to the moment where Howard can sign my one for me. I've just dropped that in the chat. Do check that out on Amazon. It's available for $18. It's a, I know you can't see it too well, but it's a fantastic book with all the iconic photographs of not just Kent State, but the weeks before and some of the stuff that happened afterwards as well. And it's a really, really interesting portfolio of history. Thank you, cast, for answering that question. Suzette, what's our next question for our cast? And those watching, if you have any questions, keep them coming in and I'll put them to people as and when the opportunity presents itself.
Right, so the next question is, what is your personal experience and knowledge of Kent State prior to the production, if any?
And the trial, if any. Trial. So, Nadia, what was your previous knowledge of Kent State?
I actually have to say, sadly, I didn't know much about it whatsoever, mm-hmm. Which is quite sad, I think. I've seen the photo. I remember when Lance was talking about this project to me of, I think, is it Mary Vecchio?
I think you pronounce it Vecchio.
Vecchio.
I'll put the photograph up.
I remember, I knew that photo existed. Mm-hmm.
That photo, just to be clear, is taken by John Philo.
Yeah.
But Howard Ruffner also took some very good photos of that same.
He did. He was, I think, more to the right on. But there are photos of Howard's that I've seen where he's capturing it from more of a profile point of view. I remember seeing that photo and having seen it before, but not knowing too much about the Kent State shootings, I'm afraid. And I think I was very overwhelmed when all of this research kind of began. Mm-hmm. I was like, how on earth did I not know this happened? I mean, I don't know.
Many people in that same situation, though, they know the photographs, the iconic photographs, but they don't know the backstory.
No.
Definitely don't know about the court case.
I mean, linking in with this question, Nadia, and your answer, and perhaps overlapping to some degree to the last question, I know we spoke earlier that you told me you'd taken my advice and you went and watched the movie JFK, which references Kent State at one point, I believe. And
that was the first film you told me to go and watch. You were like, have you seen JFK? And I was like, no, I haven't. But obviously, I just thought, okay, I'll give it a go. It's on Amazon Prime, by the way, everyone. And I saw that was 3 hours. I was like, okay, I'm going to be here for a while.
Three and a half.
Nearly three and a half. And I completely understood and got where Lance was inspired from, because that movie itself and the script is jam-packed with absolute factual information, but doing it in a way that has such story and such rhythm that it just, you kind of sail through and you're not kind of bombarded or feel like, right, I need to take a break. It's done in such a clever way, and it's exactly how, like, I'd compare it quite frankly to Lance's 5 episodes, where you kind of watch the journey unfold in front of you from beginning to end. And that was an amazing piece to watch, actually, for just reference.
Capturing the era to some degree as well.
Yeah.
Slightly before and then
The
timeline, and it runs through some of that era.
But the driving force of Kevin Costner, just absolutely obsessed and passionate, kind of reminds me of Arthur Krause's passion and obsession to seek justice. Mm-hmm. And so rightly it goes on to the lawyers as well, who take it on upon themselves and become so familiar with all the families, and it's like one big family at the end of it, really. But yeah,
I'm just gonna
thank you.
Mention a comment that's come in the chat before we move on to our next cast member. There's a comment from Laurel's Piece, who I'm assuming is Laurel Krause. And thank you for watching, Laurel. I appreciate that you're watching, and I appreciate this is not easy for people who are relatives of those who were involved. She said, "It's sad that your production chose not to reach out to my family for background on Alison, Arthur and Doris, my sister, father and mother, a real shame." Now, I just need to say that when I wrote the script in 2002, actually, I went to LA in 2003 to try and sell the script. The internet was in its infancy and I didn't have a lot of resources behind me in terms of a team or a research team. It was just me on my own, a one-man band. And the two people that I was able to find and immediately speak to was Joseph and Robert Kellner, because in the original film script, it was really Joseph Kellner's story. He was the main character, and it was really the story of the man who decided to take on this court case. Because remember, the original script was a feature film. So, and I was making it a big feature film, JFK, 3 hours, you know, little me writer no one had ever heard of, trying to sell a script that was 3 hours long. It was a ridiculous idea. But I wasn't going to let that stop me because it was a big story. So I approached Joseph and Robert Kellner because they were the people. It was the story of the trial. And this piece is still the story of the trial. And it's only concerned with the events of 1970 through to 75. Nothing that happened since. So I spoke to as many people as I could, and I asked Alan to put feelers out for me about anyone who was prepared to talk to me at that time when I was writing the script. I didn't have the contact information for all the families. The only person I was speaking to was Alan Canfora and Joseph and Robert Kellner. Alan Canfora reached out to people and told them that I was writing the script, and a few people got in touch with me. They were Thomas Grace, Dean Kaler. I mean, I've had a brain hemorrhage since then, so my memory of this period is pretty vague. But I also had a conversation with Elaine Holstein at one point. But really, that script was predominantly about the trial, and it still is. And we were adapting that to this Zoom production. So it was entirely the narrative that was written back in 2003 that was brought and then readapted for this. Now, I would have loved to have had long chats with Laurel and learned more. And maybe there'll be an opportunity to do that, because we hope this will go on and have life somewhere else. This came together fairly quickly, and I had to do a rewrite pretty fast. And I didn't even know that Allison Krause had a sister until very recently. Now, if that's my poor research, then I'll put my hand up and say that's my fault. But I honestly did not know that. And again, this script was written in 2002. So it's an adaptation of what was written then. And I didn't want to change anything in the script that I'd learned since, because it was all about what people knew in 1975. It's not about what people know now, like the audio recording of the Orders of Fire, which Alan Canfora found. And there are other things as well that have come out since. And I'm sure there'll be a forum and an opportunity to explore those things. But this is purely about what happened and what was known in 1975. And I am a stickler for facts and research. And I pumped Joe and Bob Kellner and Alan Canfora for all the information they would give me and anything that would be passed on through them. But I didn't have access. There was no social media back then. So I'm just addressing that. She says Oliver Stone's a stickler for creating dramatic works based through research and facts. Not so here. I take issue with that. I researched all the facts to the best of my ability. And if there is anything factually incorrect in the script, and I can be verified that it's incorrect, in future, if anything happens with this in future, I'll aim to correct and improve it, because directors and writers like to continually improve their work. Same question then, Suzette, to our next actor guest.
Yes, I'll ask Debra, what was your
knowledge of Kent State prior to production, if any, and the court case?
Absolutely nothing. Mm-hmm. I had not heard of Kent State. I had not heard of the court case. I had not heard of the ongoing, trials or trying to bring people to justice. I had no idea. Obviously, I was very young when this actually happened. It was a long time ago, but it was just not in my radar at all. Funny enough, I asked my mum if she'd heard of this, and obviously being that much older, she did remember it. And also she remembered the link with the Vietnam War. Which obviously, I obviously heard about the Vietnam War, but I didn't realise that this was why this all came about. I hold my hands up and say, no, I had not heard of this, and I feel terribly ashamed that I didn't know anything about this, that this had happened. I didn't know.
Thank you, Debra. And Stephen, did you have any prior knowledge?
Well, I think I must have done. And I kind of think now, yes, I've got a vague memory of that. But actually, I'm not sure how much is actually memory and how much is constructs, because I started in the business in the year that this happened, several months later, right. But in the year this happened. So I was of an age where I was aware of all these things happening in the States, but it's all lost. My memory's not great. It's not great at learning lines either. But it's lost in the mists of time, a lot of it. But I look back and I think, yes, I do remember that. And researching it, one thing I don't remember, which I should remember, is the business about the draft. And I'm not sure we touch on that in this production, that the fact that these kids, it was enormously personal for them, this business, because they didn't have the vote. They were under 21, they didn't have the vote. And the government had brought in this law where anyone over 18 could have the draft, and depending on what their birth date was and what the initial letters of their names were, they'd be called up, or they might be called up on one date or another. So it was an intensely personal thing, this war. Not only did they think it was wrong for their country, but they saw their friends and loved ones and family coming back in, I think, in boxes. They talked about boxes then rather than body bags. But they saw people coming back, people they loved coming back dead, and they risked being forced to go. And actually, what I've read is that a lot of the National Guard, the young National Guard, joined the National Guard specifically to avoid the draft, because if they were in the National Guard, they weren't likely to be sent to Vietnam. So there may well have been youngsters in that group of people who shot at the students who were only doing it to avoid being sent to Vietnam. Absolutely appalling, shocking. What's my memory of it? Did I miss half the question, or was that the whole question?
I mean, do you remember it being on the news in the UK, Steve?
I mean, you must have been a teenager back then. I remember it being on the news all the time about teenagers protesting and various dreadful things happening. But I just remember it as a mass of stuff, like Black Lives Matter now. Like there were dreadful things happening all over the place, and students protesting and what seemed like totally unreasonable treatment by one authoritative body, the National Guard or some other body, being taken against them. But it all merges into one mess of them trying to stand up and say, this is how it is. I don't know if there'll be another chance to say it. It's slightly off the subject, but one thing I didn't say to you yesterday was I just loved watching the rehearsal, how the different energies come in. And the student's energy, which is a completely different energy from everyone else, the legal energy.
We can talk about that later, because that relates to one of the other questions we've got coming up. Not to get straight too off the topic now. David, you were only 29 in 1970. In your time machine. No, I mean, you weren't born then, but... did you have any knowledge of Kent State prior from any other television films or documentaries or anything like that?
No, I've got to say I didn't. So, you brought it to my attention, actually, asking me to be involved in this production.
Very grateful that you did get involved as well, because I know you're quite a busy chap. There's a lot of chat's quite busy at the minute. I don't know about the university's view of the Kent State massacre, but the view of the people who were shot was quite important to me. And I spoke to as many of the people who were injured who would talk to me, both when I wrote the original script and since. And obviously their firsthand accounts were extremely important. I spoke to people who were there, including Howard Ruffner and others. I spoke to people who were at the court case, both who gave evidence and who were either paralegals or attorneys. And those are the two narratives we were primarily concerned with. Who was at the court case and who was there, who was also connected to the court case. And I spoke to absolutely as many people as I could. I even tried to speak to some of the National Guard who were still alive when I wrote the original script. And of course, none of them would talk to me. And it wasn't that I wanted to tell their side of the story, because I kind of had a pretty good sense of what happened there with poor leadership and several other things. But I still wanted to hear their views. And I was most interested to know if any of them had any sense of regret. And I couldn't find, I talked to the wounded students about that. And to my knowledge, there isn't one of them who in an interview many moons later, sort of, you know, as people do when they get older, came forward and said, that was maybe the most dreadful thing I ever did. And I thought maybe there would be one, but sadly, I'm afraid not. And Kenny O'Connor has joined on the chat, one of our other actors, just shouting out, "We are the outcasts," which is, we are. Very good, Kenny. Thanks, Kenny. Luke Hobson, who plays Bill Schroeder, is just adding he's had communication from family members of those involved. And first found it very useful. I've had correspondence with the relatives of the Schroeders as well, and just recently, actually, because I needed to clarify a couple of facts with some letters. So whenever there's been a fact I've needed to clarify, I've never been shy about approaching somebody. Next question, Sue.
Next question.
It's all very lively today.
How long have you been acting? And what have you done?
Perhaps just a quick overview of your career up until this point. And I'm going to start with Stephen, because somebody asked, has Stephen ever played a real life character before? And in fact, here he is. Playing one of the 82nd Airborne. And there he is. We can clearly see that, Stephen. Talking to Robert Redford just prior to crossing the river at Nijmegen Bridge in probably one of the most daring acts of World War II, which was the 82nd Airborne when they rode across the river. Stephen, very keen not to put that credit on his IMDb. A Bridge Too Far, one of my favourite films of all time. Stephen, I believe you were also in The Crown and Jewel in The Crown.
I was in the Crown and you were in the Crown and Smiley's People. Smiley's People, I would say, was my best credit, my best job all round that I was best in. But how long have I been acting? Well, I've already given that away because, as I said, 1970 was the year I came into the business, sadly. So I apologise to anyone who knows or knew Arthur Krause that I'm so much older than he actually was. I apologise too that I'm follically challenged, which he definitely wasn't. He had a marvellous and that I have a lot of facial hair. But this is for something. I'll explain about this later on because someone's going to ask me a question that will be relevant to. So I've been acting, not professionally since, but acting since I was about 6 years old, when I did Herod in a school play and had direction from a teacher who said, can you do this gesture with a combination of these emotions? And I just did it. And she said to my mum, I realized when I said this, it was a ridiculous thing to have said to a child. And then I was knocked out that he did it. And from that time, I thought I was destined to be an actor. Whether I calm myself is another matter altogether. And then at the age of 18, having not got into drama school, having not got into university, because I was determined to only do drama, and there were only three universities that did courses that were just drama, and I'd have needed really high A levels to have got in, I was suddenly lost. I didn't know what to do. How could these drama schools have made the mistake of not admitting me? It was beyond my understanding. So I wrote around to half a dozen theatres that were not more than 50 miles away. And one of them said, oh, come and talk to us. And I got there for the conversation. It was Manchester Library Theatre. I got there for the conversation and they said, oh, sorry. Well, it's nice to meet you, but we thought we were going to take on a student acting ASM and we've decided not because the management don't want to spend the £1 a week that they'd have to spend. And then I got a phone call out of the blue on Sunday, the 12th of October, the day before my father's birthday, 1970, to say, can you be here tomorrow to help us run the show because we haven't got enough people to work the lighting board, a manual lighting board. Now that's
actually younger Stephen
on
Smiley's, is younger Stephen in Smiley's People.
Oh yes, God,
there he is.
It's so long ago, it's almost impossible to believe that's me. It's very sad. I actually put up on Facebook a picture of me from another early job as Bosie in Trials of Oscar Wilde with Tom Baker, pre-Doctor Who, at the Oxford Festival in the 1970s. It's all lost back in the mists of time. And anyway, we go on and... I drifted out. Things started going quite well. The Smiley's People generated a lot of interest, but I fell into a secondary career, copywriting. And I was writing initially, it was through my ex-wife, who was then my girlfriend, and she was working in advertising on a film account. And my first job was writing radio commercials for Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom. It's ridiculous. Fantastic. I kind of wrote them on spec because they couldn't get any through with her company and they were worried about losing the business and they liked my scripts, and suddenly I was getting asked to do more work at more money, and that secondary career unfortunately took over because I was always bashing away at the PC writing stuff, and when I did get a casting, I'd held out for things that were decently paid. We were stupid enough to have a high mortgage and live in Chiswick, and I held out for the better work, and it kind of went away. And then I got divorced and looked at religions and ended up locked up for a little bit. That was interesting. But
now you're working for me. But before we hear all of Stephen's life story, I'm going to have to cut you short there.
I'm nearly finished. I came back to the business 4 years ago and I'm rebuilding my career. And I met Lance on just a very tiny job. And it shows the value of doing tiny jobs. For little or no money.
That was one where you got paid a little bit of money as well.
Being useful people.
Yeah.
And anyone who has any doubts about Lance's heart being in the right place on his work, only had to be at the beginning of this interview to hear him talking with great passion about Hillsborough. I don't know if you've all been here from the beginning, but all of his work is grounded in his wanting to tell tales that he believes need to be told as truthfully and as well as he possibly can. Well,
that's very kind, and there is a very strong truth in that, and that's probably going to be my epitaph. Stephen, I look forward to helping co-write your biography. It sounds like it's going to be very interesting. Yeah. We're going to jump on to David Wayman now, who's going to explain to us about this photo. I believe it was a blind date that went...
I'm going to plead the fifth on that one.
Which one's David?
Yeah, I think David's in the green dress with the handbag on the right there. Oh, yeah. So David, tell us about this.
This is from a film I did back in, I think it must have come out in 2016 now, called Heartache, which is a really nice, sweet little romantic comedy about... it's sort of a sideways look at the art world of how it's not a full-time job for a lot of people. And I play this very mild-mannered, let's say shy accountant who meets a beautiful French artist at a gallery opening that his friends dragged him to help him get a girlfriend. And immediately starts lying to her, because what else would you do when you meet someone beautiful that you really like? And tells her he's an artist, and she enters him into a competition. And he gradually finds his way into the art world through a genuine, genuine motivation.
I'm sold. I want to see it.
Yeah.
Available on Amazon Prime.
I've just noticed here that, of course, I knew you were friends with Johnny. This is a production. I know Ben Shockley as well. We've met at least. But Jonathan Hansler and I, we've worked together, I think, two or three times. I directed him in the Victoria Climbier Inquiry. Fantastic actor. Mm. And of course, he did a one-man show a couple of years ago that I went to see. I don't know if you caught that, which was a lot of fun. And then we all met at the theatre, didn't we, when he was understudying in the West End, and we went to see his run. And there were just like 30 of us that all knew each other, happened to be there that day going to support Johnny, which was so lovely. And we've got a big photograph of us all. I'd put it up if I could find it, but it's not on this computer. But where did you study drama then?
So I trained at East 15, and it's coming up to my 12th year since I graduated now, which is a scary thought. But I'd say as well, if there is a warm center to the universe, it's Johnny. I think everyone seems to know him, and he's an absolutely lovely guy. I've done, I think, must be 5 films with Johnny now. So Johnny was in Heartache. That first picture you just showed, that was from Martin Gooch's movie Death, which right. was my first good feature, I'd say. I've worked with Johnny, I think, at least 4 times since. And we're in a bunch of shorts together as well. Can't get enough of each other.
And I know you've got to leave in five minutes or so.
Yeah.
So I'll just talk about this now. I mean, you've got about, according to IMDb, you've got about 6 completed films coming out, 6 or and 2 in, 6 completed films and 2 in post-production.
Yeah, I had last year was an interesting one. Obviously, I was earmarked for a whole bunch of stuff that all got cancelled due to COVID. And then there was that little break in between the lockdowns, and suddenly everyone had somehow managed to squeeze their entire feature film shoots into a very short schedule. And I basically did 2 weeks back to back on like 4 different films, here, there and everywhere. So I was booked out for, you know, in what was a very difficult year. It was a great relief. I was out, I was shooting a movie called The Ledge out in Serbia, which is a thriller about rock climbing. I did Bertie Cadillac's films. Bertie also directed Heartache.
That's Howard Ford's next film, The Ledge, isn't it?
That's right, yeah. That's
lovely chap. You worked with Ben Lamb on that. How was working with Ben?
Oh, Ben's great. He's a really nice guy.
I've heard really nice things about Ben, has to be said. I don't know him. I haven't met him. I haven't worked with him. But I know about 3 people that have, and they've all said really lovely things.
Yeah, I mean, it was a wonderful shoot, that, because that, you know, everyone on it was nice. There just wasn't a bad egg in the whole bunch. It was just a really, really just great time. Yeah, love to have it again.
Fantastic. And you've got Roller Squad, which sounds like it should be some sort of 80s roller disco game.
You know, not far off. Yeah, it's a thriller about a rollerblading serial killer and a gang of roller skaters trying to catch him.
I mean, these are quite contrasting pieces to Kent State, and we're very, you know, I'm very grateful. You and I have worked together twice now. I'm very grateful that you were prepared to come, and as with all of our cast, that you were prepared to come and give your time, you know, energy and passion on this production for nothing more than a glass of wine down the pub, when we can actually do that probably in a table which will accommodate all the cast, which is a pretty big table.
Yeah.
It would be interesting to know how this experience compares to working on those productions and doing a story like this.
Yeah, I think, you know, obviously we connected over another historical drama that you'd written, Lance, and I think that's I've always been a bit of a history buff myself. And doing something this, you know, and it is very well researched, doing something that is this, and in recent history as well, it's such a, you know, when you're doing a thriller or a, you know, a drama or a rom-com, you've got a lot of artistic license to mess around and, you know, show off and do actory things. And on something like this, it's about getting it right. And it's a privilege to have that responsibility on something like this.
Yeah, and it's a huge responsibility getting it right. Laurel Krause has asked, how did we get Alison's part right without ever speaking to her family or her friends, which would be very challenging to watch your views on. The construction of all of the narrators, who of course are all no longer with us, for the first four episodes, the fifth episode is narrated by the people who were injured. Most of the information on who they were as people came from either people who knew them directly or letters and texts that they wrote. And I tried to construct their characters as honestly as I could, which, as David has just said, is very important. Now, I need to say that as soon as Laurel got in touch with me, she wanted to speak to us directly, and we arranged a Zoom call with her, with the entire production team, which she cancelled, and she cancelled it because she said that it would be too late for her to give any input because our production was so far along. It's a shame that that was cancelled, because we were making script changes on the Jeff episode right up until the day before. Not massive things, but just little tiny tweaks that would get make the character more real, make the character resonate a bit more. And of course, the actors were bringing their own things into it as well. So we were constantly revising the piece. Now, it is a bit late now because we have less rehearsal time now than we did a week ago to get things right for episode two. But, you know, Laurel, I would have welcomed the opportunity to talk to you. I'm sorry that didn't happen before now. I wasn't aware of you at the time when I originally wrote the script. When I came back to doing this project, I only heard about you extremely recently. It's not on my part that I was not willing to speak to you. I just need to say that I was. We set up a meeting, and I wish that meeting could have taken place. David, I know you've got to get off shortly. I'll just ask one question of you more before you go. What are the challenges for you? And then we can send this round after you've departed, for doing a production on Zoom as an actor. And how do you feel you have to act and perform maybe differently? Do you find that Zoom is let's say performing online is a medium unto itself? Because I certainly do, because it's not quite theatre. You can't use everything you can use in theatre. You're not on a stage. How you project is different. It's not quite film or TV, because you're not shot in a way so that people can read everything behind the eyes. So the style of acting not only has to be slightly different, and I think it's new and we're all learning it, but everything about it is different. It presents a lot of challenges, and you have a very short distance. How have you found that, David? I'm very interested to hear from you, and then we'll hear from the rest of the cast as well.
It is
before the door goes.
it's very different. You don't get any live feedback.
Sorry. You need to get that, David.
Give me a minute.
You need to go now.
Five.
Nadia, do you want to take that same question while David is rushing to answer the door?
That's very funny. So my first experience of doing anything like this was at the beginning of the pandemic, and I got involved with another company called The Show Must Go Online, and they did all of Shakespeare's plays. And it was a performance quite similar like this on Zoom and live streaming onto YouTube. And it was so alien to me. It was very strange being performative in a way that you would on stage, and then translating it through a camera lens, but you're sat at your desk in your house, in your room, not allowed to go out, and you're not having like these human interactions. So it was quite strange. But obviously, as the pandemic has gone on and a lot of our communications has been through this lens in front of us, with family members, friends, work, interviews, auditions, self-tapes. So it's all become quite normal, actually. But I think, you know, it's just a way forward through what we had to do during the time that we were in. And we putting on a show online, it just shows that you can do anything, really. And especially putting a good show on and it translating to an audience and them enjoying it as if it was a proper, you know, production, and which it is. It's just a new medium now, I guess.
And still find the sweet spot, because with acting, if you're normally interacting with somebody, there's a build-up of energy between people. Do you find you can still, because I see it coming from you, but do you feel it as the actress?
I think at first, I think you're always a bit like, oh, you know, like, I wish we were in the room together. Mm. And I think that's a very, not, you know, it can be quite an actory thing to say, because we're actors for a reason. And I think it's because we love to be surrounded by other people making art. And I think you can definitely find those moments, especially when you've got a great piece of writing in front of you. Like it's all elements of the project, really, you know. If I've answered that rightly, so.
Yeah, thank you.
No, there's no right or wrong answer. It's just your personal
experience. Yeah, really. That was my personal experience.
David's apologies, his Chinese has arrived.
Love it. Yeah, I want Chinese. That was a good call.
Debra, your thoughts on working in this medium?
I mean, obviously it's different, very different, but it's been a really good challenge, I think, to actually work on this and be able to make it work well. And obviously with a great script, it's so much easier, and you get taught little tricks of the book, you know, how to bring people in to, as if you're telling a secret and no one else knows, you know, little things like that, which is great. Thank you, Lance, for those little tips. I mean, it's I mean, I I didn't like it at first, but you get used to it, don't you? You have to. You have to adapt. You have to learn. And yeah, it's really weird. I mean, obviously, it's not going to replace the theatre by any means, or film, but it's another medium that we've used. And I think, you know, seeing that little clip at the beginning of this interview, I thought I was really getting into it. I was thinking, oh, this is good. So I think it looked great. Yeah. Yeah, I think it's amazing what people have achieved when they have to do something different.
Thanks very much for that, Debra. Stephen, what about you? An old hand at this, as it were.
You've got to stop all this old stuff, Lance. It's bad enough looking in the mirrors.
I mean, you're a veteran of many productions and many moons, and you work
just the hand
stuff and small stuff. But this is something completely new, isn't it?
Absolutely. How have you found it? And I'd split it into two different categories, and one. One is response and one is technicalities. The audience response, but it's also the vibes of being in the same room with someone. So people might be completely quiet, but you have a sense of how it's going from how they're quiet. And I don't know what that is. There's a kind of electricity in the air. And obviously you're in a theatre, you hear sounds. If you don't hear sounds, that's because they're absolutely on tenterhooks and listening and not dropping a pin to hear your every word, so you know it's going well. If you're in a film studio or a television studio, you know because of whether people are looking at you, and you can see out of your peripheral vision whether people are looking, whether they're looking at you or whether they're looking at their watches because they want to go to lunch soon, whether it's going well. At the end of Smiley's People, sorry to harp on about it, but Smiley's People, I had a really nice speech, and a long speech for television. At the end of it, the crew burst into a round of applause. Who bursts into a round of applause on Zoom? You don't hear it. It's really frustrating, but that's how it is. So we're in the dark, really, as to how it's going. We have to trust ourselves and what we've remembered from our rehearsal period. And get on with it and hope it's going well. Then there are the technicalities of the volume. There's a time lapse which differs from one person's system to another, and how good the internet is from one day to another, and from one audience member to another. Yeah. There's the sound thing. Everyone's got different mics. There's how loud you speak, how close you get to your microphone. There's the visuals. I like to have, and unfortunately using virtual backgrounds in this, it turned out there was some odd issue going on. So I did quite a lot with a group, a new writing group that I'm involved with. So I did quite a lot fairly early on in lockdown. I stopped for a long time in September. My mum died and I thought I needed to just change things about my life. And there was a pattern of one group on Monday, another group on Tuesday, and talking to my mum on a tablet on Wednesday, and I couldn't bear to go back to the same pattern without mum on Wednesday. So I learnt quite a lot just by doing little plays with this group, and I think it is a fascinating medium, and I've seen some things done wonderfully. I saw there's a place called The Space on the Isle of Dogs, where I think they're doing some really great work. They're doing a lot online. They're lucky enough to be quite good at, they've had some grant money, which would be nice if some of that would come our way, but never mind. Yeah. but they've done some great things. And something I saw some time ago, they used two cameras. They used people's phones. They had the sound on the phones, and they had they had a desktop or something, or a laptop, but they used the whole room. So you had long shots on this laptop or desktop, and you had close-ups on the phone. It was brilliant, and most people aren't doing that kind of thing, but it's got scope for all sorts of things, and it's really useful for practical things. I was at a seminar recently, two top casting directors, RSC and National Theatre head honchos, arranged by Spotlight, for anyone who doesn't know in the audience, that's an industry, used to be publication, it's now an online facility, whereby which people use for casting. And they both said, as we're all saying, well, this medium's going to be used a lot more for casting, because people are using this for initial casting all the time now. And it's going to be useful, particularly when you're casting people, even if COVID goes away completely. When you're casting somewhere in Scotland and you're in London, why bring them to London? They'll do the initial castings over this Zoom. So it is very useful, but it's damn frustrating. Excuse the swear word. It's very frustrating that we don't get any proper feedback, and we get some word feedback, but even then, it's not instinctive. Those words, someone's had that space between their instinct and their brain and their fingers on the keyboard to actually put those words on the screen. And it'll be really nice to get somewhere where we get some instinctive responses. People.
That's not Stephen.
This is me. Set up, getting ready to perform on Zoom there. I like that picture.
Now, if you had found the film in which I'm in drag, that would have been up there, but you haven't.
No, we're not going to put it up. I don't want anyone to have to go into counselling after watching. let's do some more questions. I'd like people to keep their answers short and to
sorry,
mentioning no names, Stephen. But just because I want to get through, we haven't got a lot of time. Nadia's got to go soon as well. Okay. So we want to wrap this up sort of 8:30, 8:45. We've been on a bit longer than normal. But I want to just get a few things, sort of quick fires in. One of the things that's been asked or been said is the Krauses were larger than life characters. And I get that completely. Doris is a bit harder to pin down because you can't find videos or audio recordings of her. At least I haven't been able to find any. But I have spoken to, people who were at the trial every single day and that got to know these people. And they've told me all the things that happened and how people were with each other and how they interacted and who were the dominant people and what they said and all those kinds of things. And all of that stuff has been incorporated into the piece, and this is an ensemble piece. It's a huge range of characters, and Joe Kellner was originally the lead. Now our kind of narrators are really the leads. Just on that point, you know, somebody saying they don't recognise my characterizations. They're not my characterizations. They're not my choices. As the director, I guide the actors, but I like to think that the actors make their choices about the final choices about the characters that they play. I'd like to hear a quick response from each of you on that, starting with Nadia first, about making choices for a character.
Okay. I think it comes down to there's only so much research one can do. So you can do as much, a lot, but when it comes down to, and it all is so helpful and integral to building a character, especially one of which you are, who is real, who lived and existed on this earth. It comes down to you then trusting that work and letting it almost, you're letting yourself submerge into that and then trusting in it and not overthinking it. And then, because you've got the script, you've learned the words, you know the character, and then you've just got to trust yourself. If that's how I would answer that question.
No, that's great. And I think you're right. When you're playing a real person, unless you're doing a biopic about one individual, like, you know, you're doing Nixon or something like that. Was it Anthony Hopkins that played Nixon? I'm trying to remember who played Nixon in the Nixon biography. But
I think so.
Then you're gonna have, and you know, and you're on a big budget movie or even a medium budget movie, you're gonna have months to kind of like
look exactly at
and copy mannerisms and all that kind of things. But if you're doing a play, I'd akin this to a play, like an off West End play, you know, you might, if you're lucky, have 4 to 6 weeks of rehearsals. We've had even less than that because I've been very careful not to infringe on the generosity that the actors have given, but also try and give you as much rehearsal as you require. And there's always a danger of you're trying to do an impersonation of a person. And I don't think that we can do that with this piece. You can try and capture the essence of who they were, but ultimately the final choices of how you play them are determined by what's on the page and your choices as an actor. Mm. And we discuss choices, but even when I suggest something to somebody, you'll notice from yesterday's rehearsal, for example, with Ashley, where he was doing one of the guardsmen, and we tried something different. I said, how do you feel about that choice I've suggested? Are you happy? Or do you think the other thing? And we kind of ended up with a blend of the two directions. Same question to Debra. And again, do keep the answer short and to the point, because we're limited on time now.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think you answered the question anyway, because you have to go with what's on the page.
Yeah.
And also you're portraying the essence of the character. As you say, you can't play that person. You're portraying the essence of that character. And I just hope, you know, we all hope that we do that justice, especially with this script.
Thank you. Stephen?
Well, I think those answers from the girls both were very good. We've got the script, we've got to be guided by the script, and we need to take that on board. We're not in a real room, we're not on film in a real room, we've got virtual backgrounds behind us. Are we going to make an effort to look as if we're that person and get all the exterior right, or are we going to seek the emotional truth of that person as best we can and try and put that over? Well, in this production, and I would hope in most productions, the latter is, for my book, that I think they're the wrong words, but in my book, is far more important than putting on the surface. We're not impressionists, we're actors, and we're about emotions. As far as Arthur Krause is concerned, I'm a person of enormous emotion. I've got a line in the play to Nadia Lamin, which has been said to me many times in my life, which is something on the lines that I think you feel too much, or something like that. That the number of times that's been said to me, my children still say it to me now, but it was said to me by much older people in the old days. I was worried when I saw Arthur Krause on film, I was worried that he was such a big character that I couldn't truthfully portray him without looking as if I was overacting. Yeah. And that was one of the things I mentioned earlier, where I fought against that. And with friendly nudges, as I said, from Nadia, I tried something that came closer to what I think was him in yesterday's rehearsal. And I think it's a balance that works. But we've got to do something that as far as we can do, it tells the emotional truth of the character, but it also works in this medium, whether you're looking at us on a tiny screen, people will be watching on a mobile, or an enormous television screen on your wall, which people can do by casting their YouTube. I finished.
Yeah, thanks, David. There's a lot going back and forth in chat about this. Laurel, who...
Yes.
I feel like she just wants to burn it here, but...
What are you going to say, Suzette?
I'd like to say that I think the thing we have to point out here is over a week ago, many people didn't know about Kent State. Since we've done the first episode, so many people have watched it They've gone off and researched for themselves the facts of what happened in Kent State based on watching our drama. So that's what we wanted to do. And the fact that the people of Kent State and the survivors and people who are still protesting or still working on it would want more people to know about it. And if that's what the outcasts have done, then that's what the job was. So I think it's a good thing what we're doing.
Yeah. I mean, Laurel has said that she attended the trial. That's not my information. There's no mention of her attending the trial in any of the research materials that I have. If you were there, Laurel, then it's great that was the case. But I don't have any information relating to that. I've got pictures of people attending the legal meetings, including all the families and stuff like that. And, you know, I've researched it to the best of my ability based on who was there at the time. I've let the actors go and do their own research, absolutely 100%. And, you know, Tom Grace, who was wounded on the day, was one of the first people to write to us. I mean, when I got the email from him, because, you know, I would love that this was a huge production and we had vast resources, monies, and also a huge period in which to rehearse, research, and do a lot more than is within our grasp to do. I'd love if we could do that. But unfortunately, that's not the case. We're a group of people that, as creators and as human beings, we feel quite strongly about the erosion of democratic rights in society, not just in America, but as the whole. This is the conversation that started this, shall we do this project? And everybody, after the Trump narrative, where we nearly went back to the dark ages there, and I don't want to get into all that, we all felt we wanted to do something. And I think anyone watching has to understand, it's a really big deal for 42 actors to suddenly come up to me and say, yeah, okay, I'm up for giving up. I don't know how many hours each of you are putting in, but it's probably around 300 to 400. It's quite a lot of my time when everybody's struggling to find paid work. And actually the industry is starting up again. And we've got one of our actors is filming a commercial out in wherever it is, Bologna or somewhere at the moment.
Bulgaria.
Bulgaria, thank you. And he's going to try and fly back to do this production for free, for no money, on Sunday night. You know, and these people all want to do this. It's not just about their careers. It's because they care. They care about this narrative. They care about human rights issues. They care about democracy. Tom Grace said, congratulations to you, the cast, and your entire technical team. My wife and I found the production to have been exceedingly well done. For me, it brought the past to life, with Jeff's character being particularly effective and affecting. The chronology captured the unfolding drama and reminded me of much I had forgotten. Since last year's virtual commemoration had such wide viewership, and with the upcoming tribute holding much the same promise, I honestly hope that they will include a segment of your play in this year's May 4th programme. You have every reason to be tremendously proud, for this is a truly an outstanding work. Once again, my compliments to you and the cast for a terrific performance. And we had other emails like that from other people. I won't read them all out because we'll be here all night. We can't thank Tom enough for that and tell him how much it meant to us. To have our work validated in that way. And this is just one section of the Kent State story. It's not the whole story. There are other stories to be told. There are other things that have come out about Kent State later that were revealed. You can look up more information at the Kent May 4th Memorial website. You can also go to the museum at Kent State itself. And there's also the May 4th Truth Commission, which I believe Ms. Krause is involved in. They have lots of interesting facts and information that people can look at as well. Everybody has something different to say about the day, and all of their stories and all of their contributions, especially those who were there, are extremely valid. We're only giving a voice to some of those, and we can only do our best with the limited means and resources that we have available. It means an awful lot to me to be doing this production, both for the people who were there and for those who sadly did not come back. I'm honoured to tell the story. I'm honoured to be working with this group of actors who've given up their time, who are just the most talented and lovely bunch of people I've ever had the privilege of working with. And I've worked with some really nice people, and these guys have really been the icing on the cake. So how I'd like to round things off is to just let each one of you give a final thought, anything you want to say about either being involved in the production or the role, or again, keep it short, perhaps not as long as I spoke just then. We'll go with Stephen first and get him out of the way. I'll start the stopwatch now.
Well, I'm only here to plug my next job, and you haven't asked about that.
Oh, and do mention what you're doing next at maybe the end of your final thoughts, please. Yeah, sorry, yeah. I nearly
forgot that. It's okay. It's been a great experience. I think, and I know we all feel a great responsibility that you can never truly meet, but we want to do our best to honour these people that we're portraying and to respect the people they were. We didn't meet them. We can only see a glimpse of them. What someone is in their own home is different for most people, is different from what they are with each different group of people in their lives. And then they're different again when they're in a large group of people in a very large situation, a very difficult situation like a court case. So, and I have unfortunately stood in a witness box, but we won't go there either. So where was I? I've lost that one. So I better move on to the job. Is there anything important there I've missed? I don't think there is there?
It's up to you.
It's been great. Lance contacted me and asked me if I fancied auditioning for this, and I saw his screenplay and thought it was really, really terrific. So I was very happy to audition and was delighted that he asked me to do the piece, and have been thrilled at what a good job it's been done. Lance has got a very good eye and ear, gives very good guidance, very good notes. It's a shame, because of it being in this Zoom nature, that you can't sit and have chats as actors do when they're not actually rehearsing, and hug each other when you arrive, mm-hmm. and hug each other when you part and go to the pub afterwards. But that's the nature of it. That's how it is. So that's that experience. The job I want to plug, tickets are only on sale for one venue at the moment. I'm doing a tour of Richard II that I was rehearsing in France at the very beginning of the pandemic, and we came down, we missed the beginning of all the toilet rolls disappearing off the shelves of the supermarkets. We were in Provence having a wonderful time in a stone complex, but it didn't happen back then. Obviously it didn't happen because of the pandemic, but it's now been transferred from indoors to outdoors. And we're going to tour the UK, and the place that tickets are available right now is in September will be Brighton Open Air Theatre. I can't remember the exact dates, but if you look on their website, you'll find it. So do come and see me as John of Gaunt and the Bishop of Carlisle. And there's a fantastic cast in that as well, who I love dearly.
Debbie.
Hello. I just want to say I'm so grateful to be part of this amazing project. I did do the last project with Lance. I think he's an amazing writer. He's an amazing director, lovely person, and the Outcast Creative are an amazing team, lovely people, so glad to be part of them. I am just hoping that I can portray this character to the best of my ability, get this story out there, and hopefully let more people be aware of actually what happened and what a tragic, tragic incident this was. Not only did Doris Krause lose her daughter, but then she was, her daughter was vilified because they could not, as Lance said earlier, apologise. And so to justify their actions, they had to vilify this poor girl and the other victims. And I think it's a very important story to get out. Thank you. Good night.
welcome, Debs. I hear from Suzette, but last from our cast, Miss Lamin.
Hi. do you know what? My on-screen mum and dad have basically said so many wonderful things right there. I also had the pleasure of listening on the other interview from last week. And Josie, she said, just come and educate yourselves. Come and watch and listen and learn, respect, and be part of something that happened in history that a lot more people in this world should know about. It's been a pleasure working with the whole crew. You've all been so lovely and welcoming. I've not done anything with the Outcast Creative before, but everyone's just so lovely and inviting. And I have to say, like, God, playing someone who actually existed is probably one of the most daunting things to do. Forever, you will be thinking, have I done justice to this role? But, you know, with the time that we have been given and the facilities and everything like that, we're just going to go on and do our thing and be confident in that and respect that. So, yeah.
Great. Thanks, Nadia. Before I hand over to Suzette for the final word, because she is the most important, I'm just going to give a shout out to somebody who educated me today. Demetrius Gartel, who now follows me on Twitter. Hi, Demetrius, if you're watching. He probably isn't watching, but I'm going to send him the link. I don't know how he came to see a tweet that we put out, but I put some tweets out, of course, about today. And he wrote underneath one of the tweets, Orangeburg Massacre. And I thought, what's that? I've never heard of that. And I went and Googled it. And sure enough, it was a shooting that took place at a university 2 years before Kent State, 68. Never received almost any media publicity. And you know why? Because the university was a black university, that's why. And three students were killed, one of whom was just sitting on the steps waiting for his mum. And there were, I think, 32 injured, 28 injured, quite a lot injured. And it started because of an argument over segregation at the local bowling alley. And they were protesting that the bowling alley should be unsegregated so that the black students could go and bowl there. And this spilled over to a protest on the campus. And that then erupted and the National Guard were called in, but it wasn't the Guard that killed these kids. It was the police with a combination of carbines and pistols and all the usual things. And it was a fascinating read because I had said, you know, before Parkland, before this, before that, there was Kent State. And he kind of pointed out, and before Kent State, there was Orangeburg. And I'd never heard about Orangeburg. That sounds like a story that needs to be told. I think it should be told, probably not by myself, because I need to do some comedies from time to time. I do a lot of dramatic narratives and people are always saying, Lance, you got to do this, you got to do this one. I do like to do some comedies occasionally. No one would think that, but, you know, not, but anyway, but Orangeburg is an interesting story. I hope somebody does pick that up. And Demetrius, thank you for educating me on that. I'm quite happy to be picked up on that and know that this Kent State was not the first, because I'd never heard of Orangeburg before. On that note, I'm going to turn over to Suzette and just say thank you to our cast for coming, and David, of course, who had to go earlier due to his takeaway arriving.
Priorities.
Suzette, final words from you.
Thank you. It's been emotional talking tonight. I find as we get deeper into this, it gets more emotional because it becomes more personal. I'd like to thank all the outcasts that have been with us tonight, supporting and with one hand on our backs as we go through this emotive subject. Thank you to Lance for giving me the opportunity to have this experience in production. And thank you to all the actors, and we will keep moving forward, because the more people know about Kent State and the fact that we're supposed to be in some type of democracy, and it's 51 years later and not much has changed, we have to flag these things up, and I think that's what we're doing.
Great. So, guys, we will thank you for watching. We hope to see you with us on Sunday.
Yeah.
Join us at 8 o'clock for episode 2, Allison, which will be narrated by our lovely Nadia Lamin as Allison Krause. You'll get to find out more about what happens with the court case and the opening week of that and more besides. Thank you very much for watching. We really do appreciate the support and the positive messages. Do keep them coming. Spread the word. And it's great to see how many people have watched episode 1 already.